other countries, 9, 6, and some countries are with negative sign. Of course, you all know the SWOT analysis and you know all the SWOT analysis and the country as a whole put a had put a strategy, an economic strategy, and this is a national strategy. By the way, it's not only on the presidential level, but it's also on the government and the public sector level. The need to adopt national strategy to for the financial sector to essential. In the context of building sophisticated financial sectors that open to the outside world and is able to effectively contribute to sustainable development plans and to achieve Egypt's vision to the year 2030. The national strategy outlines main objectives of a strategy for sustainable development, main directions of a national strategy, policies to be adopted, targeted results. And Egypt is among the top 40 countries worldwide in the field of innovation. Egypt is among the top 20 countries in improving gender equality, increasing the degree of competitiveness of Egyptian economy internationally, achieving an economic growth rate up to 7% on average, increasing the contribution of services to GDP about 70%. And by this plan that the government have put in place, we hope that we will reach these percentages by the year 2022. And as you see, for the insurance sector and for the private insurance and for the capital market and the leasing and factoring, the mortgage and the microfinance. And we try to make the equilibrium between being a competitive market concerning stock market, especially, and between the laws and regulations that we put in the marketplace, because sometimes they interact each other, because you wanna make a safe marketplace for investors, and you also, at the same time, wanna be a competitive market. So that's a tough equation, but I really do not have enough time to go more than that, and I thank you so much for listening, and it's a pleasure being with you today. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And I'm really sorry I've been putting the reminders to leave the desk and because we are already short on time and I'm running into the session. So the last speaker for the night, I would like to call Mr. Ibrar Mirza, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Finance, Government of Islamic Republic of Pakistan.
Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, Assalamu alaikum and good evening. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Maria and her institute to provide us this opportunity of being in the land of culture, civilization, history, music, and knowledge. In the land of pharaohs who survived for thousands of years, in the land of Dr. Taws and Lutfi al-Munfaluti, Mustafa Lutfi al-Munfaluti, who are read across the world, and in the land of Umm Kulsoom, whose musical notes are heard everywhere in the world. And sorry for this digression, I think I can afford to take time unless we are thrown out by the management from the hall. It is indeed a great pleasure for me to be here at this summit and to see this encouraging environment where we are gathered to discuss collaborative enterprises and to explore synergies of the newest and most fascinating geo-economic relationship in the world. The Belt and Road Initiative is not merely a pile of infrastructure agreements, It is indeed a new hope for international cooperation, international trade, economic development, and rise of underdeveloped and developing countries. It is a collaborative attempt to give new and higher standards of life to the people of this world. In fact, it is an effort to revive historical bonds amongst the nation along the Silk Road. It is a win-win cooperation which will bring peace, prosperity, and economic development. The Silk Road Economic Belt and Maritime Silk Road have linkage points at Gwadar and Suez Canal, which make Egypt and Pakistan the most unique amongst the nations which are part of this initiative. These strategic points can be converted into strategic platforms for growth and development of Asia, Africa, and Europe. In addition, Pakistan is also poised to serve as a linkage, a connection point between the two routes with, for all the nations along the Silk Road. That is why the CPEC has been declared a flagship project. The vision of CPEC is in fact a fusion of vision of BRI and vision of Pakistan's government, which seeks to harness our geo-economic, geopolitical position into geo-economic advantage. Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, Pakistan is an emerging economy of a population of more than 200 people with a substantial growing and rising middle class. We have rich mineral and human resources. The CPEC has already put us on the track of growth and realization of our potential. Last year we have had a GDP growth of 5.8%. Our consumption has touched the figure of 11 trillion. Our gross, it means I should end the speech right now. I thought this is an opportunity to prolong my speech. Our government is quite conscious of the fact that our foreign exchange reserves are not better. It is also conscious of the fact that our budget deficit is increasing. But these are the issues every growing nation faces. And our government is quite capable to deal and tackle these issues through intelligent adjustments, which not only ensure fundamentals of economies to improve, but also ensure the growth track and expansion must not be affected by it badly. I would have continued this speech for a long time, but since I am getting messages from the administration, so I will make it brief and say thank you to you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, all distinguished speakers. Anybody in the audience wants to ask any question?
Where is the break?
It will just take a minute.
Can you just pass on the mic?
Hello. Yeah. I just have a quick question. Salim Raza Saab, he was talking about the banking through a mobile service. I'm just wondering, mostly in China now, everybody uses WeChat as a form of payment. Do you see that coming through in Pakistan very time soon? Because they have purchased, I'm not sure if I have the right information, but I think they have purchased one bank, I don't know the exact name. If that comes through, how does it impact HBL or other banks in Pakistan?
WeChat are looking at buying a distribution platform, not a bank yet. But Alibaba has bought 40% in Telenor Bank. And Alibaba is beginning to look at this connectivity, you know, connectivity of, they're going to do payments, but then who are payments to? The payments are going to be to e-commerce platforms. So from that, they're going to hopefully start building some of what I described. They've also bought Paytm, is India's biggest payment service company, which has a license. They bought, and that's valued at, I don't know, a few billion, and they bought 40% of that. So they are making forays, and I think hopefully with their, you know, with them as the catalyst, we may see this whole digital, mobile-based. I'm not so interested in financial inclusion. It's inclusive growth, but we may see inclusive growth taking hold as small companies get access to the market, which is the biggest disadvantage. That's a bigger disadvantage than lack of credit.
Thank you very much, sir.
It was just concerning, how are the banks, Pakistani banks, going to deal with this issue?
Well, the Pakistani banks, Habib Bank in particular, is taking a great deal of initiative in digital finance. It's put a lot of money into it. It's hired a lot of people. They're coming. The Pakistani banks are coming as well. We have a lot of, we have the two telephone banks, telephone companies that are operating banks. We have a lot of fintechs, small companies that are offering nano loans, you know, 5-day loans, 7-day loans. So there's a huge amount of the big groundswell, very encouraging.
Thank you very much, sir. Any more questions? So I'll just conclude. And
I think from the organizers, the next person to ask a question will be unceremoniously escorted out of the room. So. Given their interest in having finished an hour ago, which is not our fault, it's, let me run over.
Thank you very much, sir. So I'll just briefly conclude the session. Ladies and gentlemen, let me just give you take homes. The title of the session was truly presented by the distinguished speakers from banking and financial industry of Egypt and Pakistan both. Taking some critical parts, I would like to share a couple of notes with you.
I don't have enough money.
It is very important for Pakistan and Egypt both to navigate the export finance market options, as all mega regional trade agreements will be affected by these developments. Secondly, trade finance is the crystal ball interfacing with global and regional trade partners. Having said that, banking industry will play a very vital role in the transformation and trade development for both Pakistan and Egypt. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for having all this.